Hello, welcome to the GenXplainers podcast. We have a special episode I like to call Old Dogs, New Tracks. Anyway, it's about older bands putting out new recordings. And one of the biggest recording artists of our youth and beyond, actually, is The Cure. And they have just come out with a new album. First one in 16 years called Songs of a Lost World. And we've listened to it. And we're going to talk about how we feel about it. It's our feelings. So, hello, everyone. Let me welcome the panel. Mike, Rand, and Alan are here. Hey, guys.
Hello. Hello.
Hi there. Hello.
So, like I mentioned, first album in 16 years. Long delayed since its first mention, I believe, in 2016 or so. 17, where he was like, oh, yeah, we're going to have a new album coming out. You know, and, of course, years go by. And last year, when we saw them live on tour, they performed at least four of the songs on the album. I think three or four.
Yeah, I don't remember.
And I do remember thinking, "Whoa, those are pretty good." I mean, I was cautious because, you know, I don't want to have too high expectations. But I was like, "Oh, those are pretty good. At least live, they're good." Did you guys feel that way when we saw them?
I did. I don't remember which ones they did, but yeah, I felt that they were very, very good. And that was probably one of the best shows that I've seen of theirs. So,
yeah,
I personally don't really remember being taken with the songs too much. And they didn't sound bad, but it was kind of like, oh, this is a new Cure song. And I don't know, maybe I'm too old to be able to take in songs quickly anymore. But I wasn't like immediately taken with them. They had a classic Cure sound to them. They were long. We know that much because they still are on the album. And, you know, when you're at a show and you're like, all right, you're playing the new stuff, then you want to get to some of the old, you want to hear old songs, you know. I was maybe in that mode. So, that's where I'm coming from.
Okay.
I feel like my response is very similar to Rand's. Like, I was like, this sounds pretty good, but I don't really know what it is. And, you know, maybe it is an age thing, or I don't know if it's something that I've always had. It's just harder for me to get into a song that I'm hearing for the first time live.
Yeah, I think maybe in a live setting, I think you maybe want something different from, I mean, when you go see a show of a band you like, has a catalog that you want to hear, there's always that sort of feeling of like, oh, it's one of the new songs and I don't know it as well. Especially if you've never heard it. You know, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah. And then when you get one that's really long, you're like, wow, this is keeping them from playing another song that I wanted to hear. But, you know,
yeah,
I understand what they were doing. They, you know, it was good.
They could have played half of the first album in this song.
Yeah.
But like I said, I mean, I was impressed by the songs as I heard them. And again, the tone of these songs, I can say, I think, without spoilers, is universally kind of more dirgy and slow and atmospheric. And I think an album listen, it's just a better situation. It's a better format for this type of song, I think. You get your headphones on, lay back, have some gummies. No.
Ease the seat back.
Okay, so
I am wearing my concert shirt from that tour. Then
hi, we're branded, and also Robert's here with me.
Whoa,
how was he with Mike too? Hi. Anyway, let's go track by track. Let's just pop through these. The first track is called "Alone," and that one was released as a single. So I'll start to just say that when I listened to it, when it became available, again, I was like, oh, long intro, you know, and I believe this is a song that they opened with on tour. And I remember liking it then. Again, long intro, didn't know anything about it. So I was like, oh, okay, this has the Cure mood. Awesome. But listening to it from the album, I did like it a lot. It felt Disintegration-y. Yeah, as far as song structure, right?
It's plain song 2.0 is what it is.
Right, right.
Yeah.
And he doesn't start singing until 3 minutes in, over 3 minutes in.
That's a theme.
Yep. And I did notice that the synths or keyboard and drums are very upfront in the mix, and I would come to notice that throughout the album, but specifically on this track, I said, oh, there's a keyboard wash there that's guiding the song along.
And the other thing that's very, very much up front, sorry, is Simon Gallup's bass, which is a big, big part of this whole album.
Yeah.
And this great distorted bass sound that is throughout every track, and definitely on Alone on this one. It's a big part of that, mixing in with those drums and synths.
Yeah, and I think Reeves Gabriel's guitar is very, his sort of guitar contribution is very interesting. It's different from what I'm used to, actually. It's kind of really low, very compressed and distorted, but and very kind of little flourishes. He's not like doing a big solo line or rhythm line. He's just like, and he's adding accents to the song. And
it's actually funny that it's funny. This is he's been with the band for a long time, but this is the first album he's
right.
been on.
Yeah, he's toured with them forever, but it's like, oh, this is the first one out the time he's in the production mix, you know?
Yeah, so it was great to be able to hear what his sound sounds like on the record.
Yeah. Well, why don't you go ahead and continue with what you think about this particular song, Rand?
So this whole album, I'm going to just talk a little bit about the whole album, is that it feels like Robert is trying to make Disintegration again. And he's been doing that for a while. And definitely with Alone, it kicks off that way. And like you said, this sounds like Disintegration. I have to say that I've heard it only a couple of times, a handful of times, and it's not going to sink in as much, but I don't feel like I like it as much as the older songs. Give it time, it could get, but it definitely has that feel, and I think it's a very good song. It's a great opener. Obviously, they've been using it to open their shows, and they use it at the open of the album, and a really fantastic first, opening line, which I'm not going to remember right now.
This is the end of every song we sing.
Thank you. That's why we have a group here. There you go. And so, yeah, that is a really, you have to wait a while for him to say it. But when he says it, it's a really cool moment.
I had written most of it, but I was waiting for, and in the back of my mind, I had this line about, and it was an Ernest Dowson poem called Dregs. And it was about, we toast with bitter dregs. It's a balancing act where you don't kind of like tipple over into like, oh, really, well, we're all gonna die, surprise me, it's trying to sort of dig into that and getting some kind of like emotional connection of like what you're really feeling. It's like, but essentially the songs, doom and gloom is just his fear of death. It's that simple. I mean, everything's fear of death pretty much.
I think it's a great opener and got a good feel.
How about you, Al?
When I first heard this song, which I don't remember when it was released, but I was listening to it several times over the last 2 weeks in anticipation of the album coming out. And I would echo a lot of what's already been said. It is a very much a Cure Disintegration type of song. It definitely sounded like the opening song of an album because of the long lead-in. I liked it, but I was also made nervous by it, because I do feel, as Rand has said, that the Cure, I feel, is a little bit stuck in a rut of Disintegration, and it's a great record to be stuck in the rut of, but I was just worried that the whole album was going to sound like that. So it made me a little nervous.
Okay.
But I enjoyed it.
Okay. How about you, Mike?
Well, I'm on the opposite end of that, because since I like Disintegration so much, I was okay with it sounding like that. However, I guess I don't think maybe stuck in the rut was a kind of a weird way to say it when you put it that way. For me, it's the idea that they know that that's a fan favorite album. So maybe they're trying to reclaim a little bit of that territory that they had with that album. I'm not sure. But it could just be like that's the mood Robert was in. Who knows? We'll now actually never know exactly, but I particularly like this song a lot. I can't say that I love it. I say I like it a lot.
There's a little part in there in Alone where there's a little tinkling piano thing that repeats, and it reminds me of like Cockatoos, which I love. Yeah. And I think I rated that song a little higher just because it had that little sound in it. So, okay, well, that's Alone. Let's keep moving here. The second song is called And Nothing Is Forever. My notes on it are, and this is, again, true of a couple of songs, the piano playing, or the piano is very prevalent in some of these, and just a non-affected piano, kind of a regular piano. And there's strings in the intro, so it's, again, he's implementing strings that sound a little bit better than the 80s sampled strings, but I think they're still sampled. And this one, again, the guitars are very compressed. I think that's throughout the album. This one feels like a Wish track or a Kiss Me, Kiss Me, Kiss Me B-side to me. It sounds like that era, wistful era. He had several songs kind of like that at the time.
It's a very good song. It wasn't like a song that I can, again, I only listened to it two times now. It's not a song I can go away and say, oh my God, that second track, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Well, I can say that this track and one other one I rated lowest. I kind of rated each song on a relative scale. And it's not that I don't like the song. It's fine. It's a nice song. Anyway.
So it didn't grab you immediately?
Not immediately. I mean, I've listened to the album, again, the singles that were already released, Alone and A Fragile Thing, I've heard four or five times at least. But the whole album I've listened to all the way through twice, basically.
Yep.
And in those two listenings, this one, kind of rated there. Kind of like, it's okay. It's fine.
Well, I do think that listening to the album all the way through is different than hearing individual songs. That's why the rating of songs is hard for me because of the fact that the album is an experience more so than the individual songs are.
Yeah,
so.
Like I said, it's a relative scale within the album.
Well, I'm like you guys. I've only heard this this particular track a couple of times, like a number of songs on the album. Yeah, it didn't immediately grab me. Matt, you did point out the piano. The piano has been a big part of Cure songs since, I don't know, it seems like around like Kiss Me, Kiss Me or something. I think it seems to be around the time that Roger O'Donnell joined. I think he's definitely added a big piano sound to it. I know that there was a lot of interesting piano sounds on Blood Flowers that kind of surprised me a little bit. It definitely does play a lead in this, and it's nice. I don't immediately say yes, the Cure piano, but it definitely has been a big part of their sound for a long while. And that's one thing I do like about some of the songs on this album, including this one, is when it just breaks down and it's just piano. I think I Can Never Say Goodbye, which will be coming up later, that one does a great job of bringing the piano up. So this one, piano heavy. I think I certainly need to listen to it some more to kind of get it to, but it feels, in some ways it didn't really feel like a Cure song to me. Of all the ones on this album, it felt a little softer, like he was trying to do something a little different. And I'll have to do some more listening to figure out whether it worked or not.
How about you, Al? What about and Nothing Is Forever.
Yeah, I mean, this song didn't grab me particularly. I mean, it's fine. I do remember the piano intro. I've listened to it twice as well. And when I'm sitting here looking at the track listing, and there's like two songs that don't really stand out. And I'd be curious, Matt, you said that you rated this lower along with another song. I'd be curious to see if the other song that I have matches that. But yeah, it's not particularly memorable to me, and it didn't really grab me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the second single that was released before the album came out was A Fragile Thing. That's track 3. I like the heavy bass in that one. When it came out as a single, I'll be honest, because I'd only heard Alone, and then I listened to this, I was kind of like, oh, okay, it's all right. I wasn't like totally blown away by it, or I didn't think it was as good as Alone. I still don't think it's quite as good. But after hearing it with it in the flow of the album, in the context of the album, I think I like it a little more. Again, I like the guitar solo, but it's very Disintegration. Guitar solo. I think the sound in general is kind of Wish era. And the thing about this album that is interesting is the production, and I'll talk more about that later, but this has a really high, shimmering, sizzly hi-hat sound in the mix, which I'm still not sure about. I'm distracted a little bit when I listen to the song about that, how high and how prevalent the hi-hat is, especially like in the intro. But that's my initial reaction. Again, after two listenings, maybe I'll be fine with it as time goes by. How about you guys?
This is my favorite track on the album right now, actually. Yeah, I was kind of with you. It came out as a second single, and I thought, oh, here we go, another song that sounds like Disintegration. But it's really grown on me, and having listened to the others, not nearly as much. I listened to this one a little bit more. I'm especially in the context of listening to it within the album yesterday, it pops out for me, and I like it's a little bit more up tempo. If I have one complaint about the album, it's just that all the songs kind of have the same mid tempo. And this one, I love the bass. Of course, you guys know I love bass, and this has a really, really great bass sound to it. It builds to what you refer to as the very Disintegration guitar solo. And I as much of a standard Cure sound as that is, it's what he does, and he does it well. And I like the way this song builds and then kicks into that guitar part. And there's a lot of emotion behind his guitar solos. Robert creates emotion out of guitar much more than anyone else that I know, and this song definitely has that in it. So it's a winner for me. Now I'm going to be paying attention to the hi-hat, though. So
sorry.
Thanks.
Yeah, it's not my favorite on the album, but it is the song that I feel like if we had been in the heyday of like when The Cure was on the radio a lot, this would be like a song you'd hear over and over and over again.
Yeah.
And it works. I think that for me, I prefer other songs more, and I prefer other Cure sounds more. However, I do like the song.
I like the song. I think I like the way it opens with that weird kind of sound. Maybe it's a little too shimmery and a little too hi-hat, but
I don't mind the opening sound, but when the hi-hat starts doing its stuff, that's all I hear. But I get over it. I get over it quickly. It's fine.
You get hung up on weird things.
Yes.
My shoe was untied when I listened to this, and I thought, why did The Cure do that? Why did they untie my shoe? I don't have a lot to say about it. I do like the song. For me, I don't want to get too much into like a whole talk discussion of the album, but the next three songs, like it opens a chapter of the next three, of this song and the next two songs after it, that I enjoy, is probably enjoy the most from the record. So
I'm glad you said that, because the next song that Matt's leading into right now is my personal favorite from the album.
Yeah, so that brings us to the song War Song. And yes, there's a trio of, so actually in my notes, there's these next three songs are a boom, boom, bang.
Yeah.
War Song is very, what I wrote down as when I first listened to it was, I wrote, heavy, another long intro, squeaky, squirrely guitar, love it. I love that chaotic open and this, just the building and the thrashing of it. It just fits in with the content of the song, lyrical content. I love his vocal delivery, the dark quality of the song itself. Yeah, I really, really like this song. I don't know if it's my favorite or not, this one or the next one perhaps. It's funny, my criticism of the song was I wanted it to end apocalyptically, like the beginning was. I wanted it to actually I mean, we complained about the long length of the songs. I wanted this one to be longer. It's the shortest song on the album, by the way. And I actually wanted it to devolve into something at the end to really just put an exclamation point on the message and the feel of the song. But that being said, I do love the song. I really like it.
And I like the way that you guys have framed it as like this is the next chapter on the album, because that's the way I feel about On Disintegration, going back to that, where Prayers for Rain, Same Deep Waters, You and Disintegration. This is that part of this album where those three songs in a row was what this next three songs on this album really mirrored for me.
Maybe he planned
that way. That feeling. It could be, and that's what I feel about these songs. And this one happens to be my personal favorite, but we'll see, because each one takes a different shape on the album, and it's going to, my opinion is going to form differently over time as I listen to it more, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would say that the first three definitely sound a lot sort of alike. And then this sort of breaks that mold and moves on to something different. And then, as you say, the next two after that are even more different. So I think that you guys, it's not a surprise that you guys all like this War Song a lot. I feel like this is a part of the Cure that you like more than I do. I don't dislike it, but like, would you compare this to something along the lines of Shake Dog Shake? Sort of that noisy, ranting, yelling kind of Cure sound. I was expecting more of an immediate yes. There's a lot of thought going on here.
There's a song on Wish, I'm trying to remember the name, that has, it's more fast paced, it's chaotic guitar. Lights go out, friendship die. What is that one? If only I could do
I know the song you're talking about. I can't remember the name of it right now.
A lot of wah pedal, frantic guitar. I'm blanking, but it's on Wish. Hey, in the comments, tell me what song that is. Anyway,
I'm gonna find it for you.
Okay. I get your point, Rand.
I mean, it's a side of the Cure. I brought up the wrong song.
Maybe Give Me It from that album. Maybe Give Me It is more Give Me It.
Oh yeah, you're right. That would have been a better. Well, of course, you know, no wailing saxophone in this one. But yeah,
is it cut?
I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah, it might be cut. Yeah, it's always been a part of the Cure. It's definitely a part of the Cure, that sort of louder wah-wah pedal guitar and you know, more angry lyrics that I don't know, I appreciate, but I don't enjoy as much as some of their other stuff.
Yeah.
And so Having only heard War Song a couple of times, I'm not really remembering the song. I don't think it grabbed me the way it did you guys. And Mike saying it's his favorite song on the album, I'm going to have to dip back in and listen to this one again. And it may take a little bit more time for me to get into it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm learning that Matt, Allen, and Mike like angrier songs than Randy.
That's pretty, yes, that's the theme here. That was what I meant. Thank you for getting my point.
I like the nice Cure songs too.
I know.
All right. Well, Allen, what do you think about War Song?
Well, obviously we know I like angry music, according to my friend. No, I do like the song a lot, and I do like the chaos of it. The Cure songs that I like, well, I like all kinds of Cure songs, but I do like the rawness. And in that, I will say this does have some kinship with Shake Dog Shake, because it's a very raw kind of feel to it, and especially lyrically. And I like that it breaks it up musically. Like the first three songs feel lush. Like that's the thing that I don't want the whole album to be washes of lushness. I like there to be, you know, some musical sonic variation. And so it was, I enjoy hearing a break from that. And I do like the angry, chaotic songs. I like them a lot. You know what? I'm not going to apologize for it.
This is a safe space.
I do think that lyrically, this particular song is one of my favorites, just lyrically too, not just the music, but also what it's saying too. Yeah, although I pulled them up now, and I will say the first three lines have misery, bitter, and death in them. So I mean, I guess that says something about me. There's also vengeful in the first few lines.
Yeah. All right. Let's move on. You mentioned lyrics. I actually think this next song called Drone, No Drone. This is track 5. And this one, I love this one. The bass in this, Rand, you should love this bass, because this bass is awesome.
And what makes you think I like bass?
Well, I know some people like treble, some people like bass. Yeah. Well, I like the kind of sound that's in your face. Let me just say, okay, drums and bass, great, very heavy, but and I love the wah-wah guitar solo again, very wah-wah, squirrely. It's interesting because the lyrics are almost, they're kind of playful. I like the way he keeps talking about his inner monologue, and it all starts with, and then I'm all, and then he gives the quote of what he's thinking.
Yeah,
but then it's all, and I think the lyrics are actually very, I enjoy them a lot, and they're kind of funny. Maybe they're masked a little bit by the music, but I do like this one a lot. This ranks very close with War Song as far as like relative enjoyment on the record.
Yeah, I put this on my second favorite on the album. So I think we're in that bridge of like those three songs in a row where it's just that's the part of the album that I love the most, and this is. War Song and then this one are my two favorites. I go around and around on like what my personal favorites are, but this one is probably, it's going to be very close on the call, and I do think it's a great song. I again, the bass line, drums, all of it.
So I have to, it sounds like I need to listen to this album some more, because I have to admit, you guys are talking at a level like you've heard it a bunch of times or something. These War Song and Drone, No Drone kind of like blended together for me, and I can't distinguish between the two, and I have very little memory of them other than that they stood out from the other tracks on the album. Those are the only notes that I have. So it is nice, as you mentioned, Matt, that with the wah-wah guitar, I'm sure that's, it's nice that Reeves gets to like put his stamp on the Cure album and you know, get a nice guitar sound in there. But yeah, I need, I in all honesty, I need to go back in and listen some more, because these tracks, I remember their sound, but I don't remember a lot of details about them.
And to be fair, the second listen through, I did kind of follow with the lyrics. I had the lyrics up for a lot of them, and this was one of them. And I think that added to my kind of appreciation of like, oh, I like the way these lyrics are working in with this song. So.
I think I'm similar to Mike in the sense that I keep going back and forth between whether I like War Song more or this more or the most, you know, from the album. It really is. I like the song a lot. I like the up-tempo vocals and the kind of the insouciance as opposed to the kind of just somber, like, oh, I'm miserable. Which, again, I like that a lot. I'm not. I just
sounds
feel like
it.
No, they do it a lot. You know, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
Like, do two or three of those and then just go home.
We've already established that you were worried about the whole thing sounding like Disintegration, and these two songs pop it out of there, right?
Yes, they do. They make me a lot less nervous. And I should take back what I said. It's not that I was worried that it would sound all like Disintegration. I was worried that it would all sound like Plainsong. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
was what I was worried about. Because Disintegration does have breaks. It has Lullaby. It has Fascination Street. I mean, I just like a little more variability. And this provides it. I also, like I said, I like the vocal cadence that, I don't know. I really don't know. All that. I like it. I like it a lot. Really don't know like that. I don't remember the words, but I mean that's how it is in my head. As I'm washing the dishes, I'm just like, I don't know. I really don't know.
Tying your shoe that Robert untied.
The next song on this is called I Could Never Say Goodbye. And this is, again, the chapter of the three songs. The grouping of three songs. This is a strong song. It's and talking about Disintegration, it starts with a thunderclap. It's like a...
I'm a little surprised they did that again.
It's an interesting choice. It's like, really? Okay.
And I wrote this song a lot of different ways as well, until I hit on it's a very simple narrative of actually what happened on the night he died. So it went all around the houses. I went everywhere with this song to try and sum up how I felt, and in the end it just turned into like a reasonably bleak little vignette.
I take personal baggage into it. I find it heartbreaking and affecting. He did perform this live when we saw him. I remember it because I remember thinking, oh, wow, that's a powerful song. But I can say that the live version, the studio version kind of packs more of a punch because it's more intimate, I think.
I like this song a lot. It's not my personal favorite on the album, but again, these three songs in a row really work as a general feeling, and as you guys put it earlier, this chapter of the album, I think, works really well to close out the chapter and lead into the next ones. And I do like this song quite a bit, especially lyrically. It may not be my personal favorite, but I think that it's a strong song still. So
one thing to mention, which I think is kind of obvious, this is a very mature album. It's a step forward, I think, for The Cure and for Robert with his songwriting. And it's a little different, you know, it's more personal than anything else they've ever done. And this song is at the center of that, I would say. And yeah, just the fact that it's about a family member, you know, I'm sure he's written other songs about people that he knows, but it's just been known from the first time we heard this song what specifically it was about. And it just, you know, it's a very, very emotional song, very touching. And I think it's very well done. I have it, I after A Fragile Thing, I think it's like, it's one of my favorites on the album.
I think this is a really good song. It is, I mean, it's like not my favorite song, but it is pretty moving. And, you know, starting off with, yeah, the thunderclap, but also the, just the piano throughout that really, I think, grounds it. And it is, it's raw in the, a different way, not in the shake dog shake kind of way. It feels different. Like it, the depth of the emotion feels different. And maybe I'm just adding that because I know what it's about, but I think it actually feels deeper, like a more laid bare than most songs of the Cure, which are, a lot of them are like, here's my insides, look at them. Very poignant.
All right, so the next track is All I Ever Am, and penultimate track. Notes I have for this one, drums again very prevalent in this one. Drums are high in the mix, and there's more of that nice compressed little guitar flourishes going on. I don't have much more to say about it. I like the song, but it's one of the two songs that I mentioned that I felt were kind of sort of just there, and I enjoyed them, but it looks like Alan agreed.
Same one.
Again, it's a fine song, but it didn't stand out.
Yeah, I mean, of the album, this is one of the songs I forget the most. And that's just, it didn't leave an impression on me, and it could change over time, as we talked about, as we listen to it more, it could change over time, but it's one of those songs that I'm like, that's right, this is on the album too.
If I know you, Mike, you tend to get sleepy after about 35 minutes.
that is true.
And that's right. Mm-hmm. About when this kind of,
and he does long intros, and I usually fall asleep before he actually starts singing. So.
Right. You know.
And we'll get to that long intro in the next song. So,
longer and longer. I mean, as a point, I do find that I do enjoy the song more when he starts to sing. I think some of the intros on this album are a bit long, and I would prefer it to tighten it up a little bit. But that's me. That's me. I didn't write the album. I'm not out there spending 16 years making an album. So what do I what? What I say is not that important. I would say I don't have a lot of memories of this song either. That's the theme for me, isn't it? That I need to go back and listen to it some more. And you know, that's the truth, is that I need more time to process these songs. I remember it, you know, in general, this whole album sounds really good. I'm happy with it, but I need more time to listen to this, and this is one of them that didn't jump out at me. I remember it being pleasant, not angry.
It's quite polite.
Yes.
Doesn't ruffle your feathers.
But fits in with the theme of the album, the mature sort of personal touch, lyrically.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I said it all with my thumbs up earlier. This is, again, this song is fine. Like, I have no beef with it. I just don't really remember it much. I feel like this is definitely a song I should listen to again to have more of an opinion about. Yeah, it's fine. It's totally fine.
So with that, let's get to the final song on the album. And it's not called the final song. It's called End Song. And as we mentioned, it's over 10 minutes long, but he don't start singing until about 6 minutes. Very long intro, very perhaps purposely disintegration-y. Even the
almost
title.
Pornography-y. I would say. With the toms, are very pornography.
Yeah. I think it's a very good song. It is too long. I mean, I don't mind a long intro in general.
Do you like 6.5 minute
that's
long
kind
intros?
Of a, that's a bit much. I mean, you know, I understand the power of a song, or the value of a song creating a mood that gets you into the, that eventually gets you to a point where the lyrics come and sets you up. And again, I've only heard this song twice. I think it might be a bit much. I don't think there's enough going on and building to maybe warrant that long of an intro. But again, on further listening, maybe I'll be like, yeah, it's fine. Or whatever, I'm grooving, I'm vibing into it. La la la.
It's very Cure. he does the long intros. I do feel 6.5 minutes is a long intro. However, I'm so used to it, I kind of expect there to be at least a song on an album with a long intro. This happens to be the longest one on the album, and it's the final song. But you know what? Musically, it still sounds great. And while I do not put it anywhere near my top track on the album, it's fine. I'm okay with it. I need to listen to more, and I do agree with you. There's a certain feeling vibe you get into as it goes. It's not going to be on my playlist rotation for a long time.
It's not a party playlist classic. All right, no, people, come on.
It isn't. I don't think my family is going to really, hey, put that song on, Dad.
Well, quickly on this song, I think lyrically it's very, very strong. And I think it's a good. He had said in the interview that, you know, the album kind of coalesced around the Alone and this one, and he knew it'd be Alone would be the opener, and he knew that this would be the closer.
End song, I wrote it just in one night, and it was actually in 2019, because the album, the sessions were called Live from the Moon, because it was the 50th anniversary of Apollo 11, the lunar landings, and I was actually outside, and I was remembering back to, you know, I think I was 10 years old, and I was in the back garden with my dad, and I remembered, you know, the feeling of like, really, you know. The world that I was born into was getting incrementally better every year, every year. It just seemed that the world was on an upward trajectory, and the moon landing was part of that. And around that time, I turned 16 in 75, and it seemed like the world sort of like stalled, and then it's been travelling downhill ever since. And I mean, that's the core, that's the beating heart of the album, of the Songs of a Lost World. That is in the lost world. And I realised when I wrote that, you know, I just wrote that in one go outside, but like, this is how I feel about, you know, the young me, where did it go, sort of thing. And it's at that moment I thought, well, that's the end song. I've got the end song, I've got the opening song, you know. So it was I think that those two moments put together, and both happened in 2019, I sort of knew that, you know, which is probably why I started blathering about the album to people. We've got a new album, we've got a new album. When in fact we had like 26 pieces of music and two songs.
It's already been said, it's a very long intro. I honestly wasn't really looking at how long the song was going to be. So I just thought, oh, they're ending it with an instrumental. That's kind of fun and interesting. Because it was 6 minutes into it and it hadn't started. Musically it was good. I would have been fine with that. It's an odd choice for them, but it's hard for me to have much of a grasp on this song because it's so long, and because the lyrics don't start for a long time. I only listened to it twice, And both of those times I found myself kind of like thinking about other stuff and like things I had to do. And I, you know, it just kind of like lost my train of thought. I wasn't like actively listening. So I do feel like I need to listen to this one more as well. But I did like it. And I don't have a problem with a long Cure intro. One of my favorite Cure songs has a really long intro, but that would be The Kiss. For anyone who's got their Allen scorecards. But yeah.
Bingo!
Oh, you won. What are you in?
Yeah.
I thought it was good. I thought it was, it just kind of trailed off. The album just kind of trailed off for me. But it was fine.
I do find it funny that when I looked up the lyrics just now, it has the lyrics and then chorus and then instrumental bridge. I'm like, you spent 6.5 minutes doing an instrumental. Why do you have to put this in the lyrics?
Yeah, we need right, a little Randy. More. We need to open up this song a little bit.
So when the song started, like kind of like when the thunderclap goes on, I Can Never Say Goodbye. I thought, what? This is what it sounds like? Because it's just, it was such a classic Cure sound that those heavy tom drums, they use those on Burn, which they've been playing a lot live. It reminded me a little bit of an old B-side called Splintered in Her Head. And that one is a very long kind of drony thing that doesn't really do much, which is how I would describe this one. It's 6 minutes of build that doesn't change a whole lot. And then the guitar kind of slowly comes in. That classic wah-wah sound that The Cure likes to use a lot. I again, only listened to the song twice. The first time, I was not very taken. And the second, I kind of got into it. So it's a little bit like what you said, Matt. You know, it's like you have to be in the right mood. You have to kind of embrace it and get into it. And it's not like I don't like a long song by The Cure or other bands. You know, like there's a live version of Faith that's 10 minutes that I want that song to never end. And that does the same thing. You know, it's that bass line here that there's just kind of, and the simple drum, and that can go on forever. And I love that. So this one doesn't hit me the way that does, at least not yet. And as you say, it's not going to pop up on a playlist at all. You know, it's you make a song 10 minutes, it's not something that I'm going to like want to put on a lot. But in the context of this whole album and as a closer, to bookend it with Alone, I think it's a great thing.
Yeah. We hope you're enjoying this GenXplainers podcast. Please remember to find us and follow us on social media. And we'd much appreciate a 5-star rating on the podcast platform of your choice. Now, let's get back to the show. Mike, you were talking a little about the full album, how it felt like chapters or maybe even like a book. Robert's bedtime stories, you know.
No.
You should read it to your kids.
Yeah.
Play it for your kids.
Yeah. So is there anything?
No reading. Just read the lyrics.
Is there anything else you wanted to say about it? The full album?
No, I just felt like this is one of those things where we've all kind of touched on it during this conversation. And I like, again, I was saying earlier that I like the way Alan phrased it, like this is the next chapter. And I do think that this feels like an entire story, the album, to me. If you listen to the album as a whole, which I've done twice now, and it really works on that level where it feels like there's a progression, a beginning, middle, and end to this album. And I like that aspect of it where lyrically, musically, and everything, it has that feeling throughout. And so I do like that aspect of it. And it works really well, I think. You go to this sort of like, I can't say any of it's happy, but you go to this sort of pleasant feeling at the beginning to this darker feeling, then to a really dark feeling. and it just progresses as it goes. And I do appreciate how he really thought out the process of putting this together. So,
yeah. How about, Rand, just in general, the whole album, reaction to it feel?
Like I said before, I feel like he's the band has been trying to do a version of Disintegration overnight. They did it with, I felt, with Blood Flowers. And I actually liked Blood Flowers a lot when it first came out. I kind of like what you were saying earlier, that I need to go back and listen to that again, see whether it holds up. But, you know, this feels like they're trying to do the same thing again, but but taking it to a new mature level. And this is stuff I feel like I've already kind of said earlier on. So I don't know if I have a whole lot more to add to that. It's, I think it's a good step forward for them. I'm if they do indeed have two more albums coming at some point, it'll be very interesting to see whether he shifts gears again and they go into some different style of songs, or whether they're going to kind of keep doing this sound. But I think this is a really good collection of songs, and though it does pull from the past quite a bit, it does move forward a little bit and has a maturity that is makes it a little bit more interesting than just a rehash of old stuff.
Cool. How about you, Al?
I like this record. I mean, I know we're not talking about like compared to others, but this is the Cure album that I've liked the most in the last 20 years. I mean, well, 16 of them, there was nothing, but last 20, 25 years. I was worried that it would be a little monochromatic based on Hearing Alone and even A Fragile Thing a little bit. But I don't feel like it is. And, especially with the war song and Drone, No Drone. I would echo what Rand said. I think there's a maturity there. And it is all of a piece. It works together like this. I would not expect to have like a Friday I'm in Love just like wedged in there. It's like my brother died, but it's Friday I'm in Love. I love watching you eat in the middle of the night. And musically, I think quite good, quite. Yeah, no, I like it. I like it a lot. I mean, it's not going to be my favorite record, but I do like it. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, my sort of notes on it after listening to it all the way through once was Robert's voice is still very strong.
Yeah.
I mean, I was...
Really?
Yeah.
And maybe that's just because that he sings in a way that's forgiving, but it sounds great on this record. He really does. And I think the mix and the sound... especially the guitars is a little different, and I think that's Reeves Gabriel's addition to it. I do think that is different, and I'm talking mostly about the little, very subtle guitars low in the mix, but the little subtle things that he's doing within the song. That's something to look for when I listen through again. Really nice. Yeah. I think that, like we talked about, the track sequencing is very good. Really does make sense to flow through that way. No happy pop tunes put in there. I think, again, it's a cohesive, self-contained story of where his head was the end of the 2010s, And I think he accomplishes that really well to illustrate that, what he's going through. And I think that's great. I think it's really good. This reflection he's doing. I think it's a strong album, very much a throwback in tone. The production of the album, I'll mention really quick, is a little, everything's this way now. I get it. I understand. But it's really compressed. And when I compare it to Disintegration, which to me feels very open and spacious in its grandiose, lush sounds, this one's compressed and jammed into a ball or something. It's very compressed and it's very narrow. I think I would have liked more dynamics and openness in some of the songs and some of the parts to feel it expand a little more. But on the whole, I think a thumbs up from the GenXplainers crew. Definitely check it out. If you're a Cure fan, you've already checked it out. But if you're Cure curious, This,
if you're not a Cure fan, you probably haven't made it this far through the podcast.
You don't even, yeah. You saw the thumbnail and went, Cure, whatever.
That's good.
And I do want to say that it's worth checking out their live concert for the album.
Yes.
On their YouTube channel, because it's a really, really good show.
Yes, it is.
Really, it is good.
They've got a
lot. I'm hoping to check that out.
I actually like the Cure live better than I do on record. So, it's a great way to hear the album and a bunch of old songs.
Yeah, and actually other concerts. Yeah. I mean, other concerts they've been pretty good about, I mean, it's very available online, YouTube, many of their shows. But yeah, this, the one they just did, that 3-hour one, great show to watch. Again, Robert's, even live, is not studio trickery. His voice is great. It's a great show. It's a great show.
And I'm glad you talked about his voice, because I thought when we saw him live a couple of years ago during that tour, it sounded so good live. And it just, I'm just amazed that he, at the point he is in his career, that his voice is still as strong as it was back then. So
yeah, and he's gone on record to say that performing live the past decade or so has been his favorite part of The Cure.
Yeah,
he talks about the early days of recording, and that he doesn't, you know, it's not as fun, and it shows in the recent concerts. He seems like he's just happy to be there, and he's really an advocate for his fans. And he's, you know what, he's a good guy, that Robert.
And if you watch the live show online, you see him smile actually quite a few times.
Yeah, he's happy to be there, and he loves performing. So good on you, Robert. And with that. Thanks for listening. If you got all the way through this, good show. It's like an intro to a Cure song. This thing was so long.
It's longer than the record.
All right. Well, thanks, panel. And let's all say bye-bye.
Bye.
See ya.
Bye.